Always Encrypted has been around for a while. In this episode, you'll learn about Always Encrypted V1 and how Always Encrypted has improved in V2 in SQL Server 2019. Tune in to this episode of Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, we're very lucky to be joined by a security expert, Mladen. Mladen, thanks for being on the show. Can you tell us a little bit more about yourself and what you do?
Sure. Hi. Thanks for having me. So my name is Mladen Prajdić. I'm an MVP, been one for 11 years. I live in Slovenia. I've been working with .NET and SQL Server for the last 20 years now, and I've been involved in all kinds of projects from like classic line of business to image processing to the security stuff to, you know, optimizations. In my free time, I do a well-known add-in for SSMS called SSMS Tools Pack. And that's about, and oh, I'm also an organizer for a local SQL Saturday. I go to a lot of conferences and give sessions about any topic that interests me, and that's pretty much it.
Awesome. Well, we're excited to have you. It seems like maybe not just security, but lots of topics are in your bandwagon. So thanks again for joining us today. Today specifically, we're going to talk about Always Encrypted in SQL Server 2019. And this is a really interesting topic. And I think I mentioned before the show, like, I'm excited to have you on and talk about this. I think it'd be good to start off maybe with you telling us your thoughts on why end-to-end encryption is useful and what Always Encrypted or Always Encrypted with Secure Enclaves kind of brings to the table.
So for me as a user, end-to-end encryption is very important because I know I can be sure that my data that I send to the server cannot be accessed by anyone, even by the administrators at the company I'm sending the data to. Before Always Encrypted, this was very hard to do because all of the keys, the passwords that would decrypt the data would be stored on the company's servers, right? With Always Encrypted, the key or the password is stored with me. But that's the basic, the main, not priority, but the main improvement over the general encryption, the way its encryption is being done.
Awesome. Cool. I like that simple explanation, but also very helpful and relevant. Now, today, we're going to go deeper into this topic, and I know you have some content prepared to us, so I'm kind of just going to pass it to you and let you teach us, teach me, because I don't know a ton about it, how Always Encrypted works and what are some of the things we need to know.
Okay, cool. So we'll take a look at a few slides, and I won't be long. Okay, so the Always Encrypted in 2019 SQL Server, I call it the searchable encryption because that's basically what it is, right? So we'll go first, we'll look at how Always Encrypted version 1 works. This was introduced in SQL Server 2016, and it basically does, what it does is very simple. You have a client, which runs on a modified or improved Ada.NET driver, and you send the data that you have unencrypted to the driver, and the driver encrypts the data, sends the data encrypted to the SQL Server, which that data gets stored or gets queried, and once you get the result of your query, the still encrypted data comes back from the server to the client, and then the client decrypts that data. And the actual password or the key for decryption is never sent to the SQL Server. So even if you have sysadmins on the SQL Server, they cannot decrypt the data because they don't have the key. They don't have the means to decrypt it. Right? The downside of this is that the data is decrypted on the data is encrypted on the client as in is encrypted on the stored encrypted on the server, meaning that you cannot do any kinds of like searches or pattern matching or anything like that, right? And if you have a business case where this is important, you cannot really use it that well. this is where version 2 comes in, right? So version 2, which was introduced in 2019, SQL Server 2019, introduced the concept of a secure enclave. Basically, what this does is it takes a memory space, you know, on your SQL Server, puts the encrypted data into that memory space, and decrypts it there, makes the operations of pattern matching that you want to do there, and then returns the encrypted data back to the client. Now let's see what it actually. Otherwise, it behaves the same as what was encrypted version 1. So what is this secure enclave that we're talking about, right? It's basically a virtualization-based security feature. It's an isolated region of memory within the address space of a user mode process. So basically anything that is not a kernel mode process, it's a user mode process. So SQL Server runs in a user mode process, right? So it is basically an isolated region of memory in the SQL Server process. It's controlled by the Windows hypervisor, and the data that is sent to this secure enclave is only accessible by code running in the enclave itself, right? But the enclave itself has something called code integrity, and it's basically a restricted instruction set. So it can do very little things, but it can still do cryptographic computations. And this code that is run in the enclave is also signed with a key and checked for validity and if it hasn't been tampered with or anything like that. The version of Windows that you need for this to work is either Windows Server 2019 or Windows 10 version 1809. Now, always encrypted version 2, sorry, version 1, only needed SQL Server. That's it. You didn't need, you didn't have any other dependencies. For version 2, this changes. You need something called a host guardian service, which basically it proves to the client, so to me as a client, that this VBS enclave, the secure enclave of the SQL Server, is in the correct state and it can be trusted. And this host guardian service is on a separate computer that is that should be adminned by people not adminning your domain or not have anything to do with SQL Server. And now the way it works, the always encrypted, is you have two keys. Basically, you have an enclave-enabled column master key and a column encryption key. The data in your column is encrypted with the column encryption. And the column encryption key is then encrypted with the column master key. But the password or the certificate for your column master key, so the way to decrypt the column master key, is not stored on the server. It's stored with the client or in some other secure location that you can access. And you need .NET 4.7.2 for this to work. You can enable it in the connection string or in the application itself via a property for SQL command object. If you put something called attestation URL in your connection string, version 2 of always encrypted will be used. If you don't put this URL, version 1 will be used. And this attestation URL is the URL to your host guardian service machine, right? So this way the client knows that it has to contact this host guardian service machine and make it prove to the client that the SQL Server it connects to has its VBS enclave in the correct state, right? Now there are two ways to encrypt data, deterministic and randomized, right? Deterministic is once you, every time you encrypt the data, the resulting ciphertext will be the same. Randomized encryption means that every time you encrypt the data, the resulting ciphertext will be different. So randomized encryption is completely random, as the name states. Deterministic one, you can guess what the encrypted value is by, you know, if you have like a column that only has male, female values or countries that you do business with, and if somebody knows that you're doing business mostly with the US or the UK or the EU or something like that, they can probabilistically guess that that data is that country that you do most, most work with, if you're encrypting it deterministically, right? Because that's the value that is happening most in your data, right? Okay, so what you can do with V2 that you couldn't do in V1 is you can do in-place encryption. Basically, you have an existing table and you just say encrypt my data in the table. You can also re-encrypt the column data, right? So if you have key rotation, if you want to change your column encryption key, so if you want to change the actual key that your column is encrypted with, you can do that. So basically, you just re-encrypt the column data. You don't have to, you know, take the data out, re-encrypt it, and then put the data back in like you had to do in V1. You can change the encryption type. You can go from deterministic to randomized or vice versa. You can, of course, decrypt the data, right? And best of all, it supports all collations. V1 didn't support all collations. Now, if you want to do rich computations, so pattern matching, like searches, stuff like that, that only works for bin2 collations, right? Because those are binary collations, and it's just it's a matter of scope of work, right? It's something that just hasn't been done yet. So I'm assuming this will be done moving forward. So how do we do this, right? In-place encryption, you just say alter table, alter column, and you say encrypt with the encryption type you want to do, the encryption key you want to use, the algorithm, which is just one, but is enough, and that's it. And these two statements will encrypt my salary column and my SSN column, right? And I will have randomly encrypted data. So it's very simple. Compare that to V1, where you had to take the data outside of the table, encrypt it, and then put it back in, and you had to change the schema of the table to fit that var binary data. This is very much better, right? It's a high improvement compared to V1. And now,
awesome. Mladen, quick question. Sorry, a lot of this is new to me, so I'm still learning. You know, it seems like it's fairly easy to use once it's set up, right? What is the setup process like? Because you mentioned there's now a new service that you have to configure in order to use this always encrypted V2.
So here's the thing. I have a whole day session about always encrypted V2. And on the setup, I spend about a third of it.
Okay, so it's not trivial.
No, it's not a trivial setup. So just to set up the host guardian service correctly, for testing, it's very simple to do. You just follow the procedure. But for actual production, it's not that simple. It's you have to have different people validate the installations, all administration, all these things. But in the end, it's just you follow the procedural steps and that's it. On the SQL Server side, it's basically the same. You just say I want to basically register my SQL Server with the host guardian service with a certificate, and you copy that certificate over, and they know how to talk to each other this way. And then in SSMS, you say this is my master key, and that's it. The main thing is that you have to enable the column master key has to be enabled for secure enclaves. If you don't do that, it will not work.
Okay, cool. That's good to know, and we'll definitely point our viewers to some additional resources that you might share with us after this, so they can learn more if they're going to set this up.
So I don't have a link, but if you use your favorite search engine and you type in setting up always encrypted with secure enclaves, it will be the first result. The
awesome. Whole
thing how to do it. The documentation, the Microsoft documentation on this is actually pretty good.
Good. That's what we like to hear.
I've been following. So interestingly, the same documentation for the CTP version of SQL Server 2019, it didn't work. But because CTP, right? But for the production version, it's fine. It works.
Wonderful. Awesome. Sorry to derail you there. I was just curious.
That's fine. Okay. I don't have much slides left. So, and basically this is how you do rich computations and pattern matching, right? One thing to note, though, is that rich computations with secure enclaves are not enabled by default. So you have to use a trace flag, 127, to enable them. So once the server starts, you have to run this DBCC command. Otherwise, it won't work. And you have to just run it once. And then when you do rich computations, it's the same as when you do normal pattern matching. And that's the whole point, right? This is what you want to do with encrypted data. And the way this works is your query is basically sent from the client to the SQL Server with encrypted data. The SQL Server knows it has to use a secure enclave. The secure enclave, because it has been proven by the host guardian service that it can be trusted, asks for your master key from the client. The client sends it to the secure enclave directly, and it uses that to decrypt the data in this secure enclave. And then it create it does this pattern matching and then returns just the IDs of the rows, right? It returns it to the SQL Server, and then SQL Server returns those rows back to the client, encrypted. So this has to be emphasized. The data in the SQL Server is never decrypted. It's only decrypted in the secure enclave. And interestingly, though, if you want to like profile or check or debug this secure enclave, it will fail the secure memory space requirement. And it will just it will show as I think as empty. I think it shows as empty. I'm not quite sure. It will basically report to the user that something has failed. Something is not secure. So what you can do for the end, this is a nice table of what is actually supported, right? If your column is not enclave enabled, and if it is enclave enabled, and depending on the encryption type you have, right? So for randomized encryption with an enclave enabled column, you can basically do everything. You can do in-place encryption, you can do equality comparison, you can do alike, you can do pattern matching, everything is supported. If it's not enclave enabled, the only thing you can actually do is do equality comparison with deterministic encryption, because you know you cannot compare something with randomized encryption. And that's pretty much it. This has been a very quick overview of Always Encrypted V2. The point of all this was to somehow bring it closer to you, to demystify it, right? And to maybe start to make you go think about if you can somehow implement it in your environment.
Yeah, thanks, Mladen. I mean, this has been really interesting. I especially liked your table that you showed at the end that kind of gives us that comparison. And for me, at least, and I'm sure for many of our viewers, you did help in demystifying some of the things related to this, as far as setting it up goes, as far as using it goes, and as far as like what you actually get depending on what you're using. You know, if you had one tip for our viewers as we kind of close out that are just getting started with this, what would you advise them?
So tip for encryption or?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Don't be afraid of it. don't be afraid of it, because for me, it seems that encryption has this, that still has this a negative meaning, that somehow if you need to encrypt your data, you're doing something wrong. This is nonsense, right? Because I always say that your user security comes first, right?
But, awesome.
With all the breaches happening today, encryption counts.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's very important. And so we really appreciate you coming on the show and sharing this insights with us. We'll find some links and we'll share them with the viewers in the description to this. If you like this video, please go ahead and like this video, subscribe to our channel. And we actually have some very exciting news in our next episode of Data Exposed Live. If you are watching this the day it airs, tomorrow in Data Exposed Live, we will be hopefully sharing some exciting news around Always Encrypted. So be sure to tune into that as well. Thanks for viewing, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.